extend a cordial welcome to all visitors joining us today on Low Sunday. I suppose it's called Low Sunday because after Easter, it's not quite as festive. Last week we had a solemn Mass, solemn High Mass last Sunday. And now we just have an ordinary High Mass, which is also very nice. And we hope to have High Masses every Sunday. Sometimes it's also called, there are other names for it, Divine Mercy Sunday is the latest, which celebrates, of course, the great mercy of God in His forgiveness, and is connected in modern times with the apparitions of Sister Faustina. That's one of the reasons that Pope John XXIII and John Paul II were canonized today in Rome, because of the importance of that theme. Before I go into the homily, I have some news to convey to you about the future of our parish here. I do it really with reluctance. Officially, beginning on August 1st of this year, I will no longer be your pastor here at Starvesen Parish. I received this news last week. August 1st, so we have 3 months yet. And when the bishop told me about this news, I said, but I like it there. I love it there. He said, well, I know that, but we have discerned a different situation for Starvesen Parish. And that is that beginning August 1st, or around that time, Starvesen Parish will have two oratorians coming here. They will be setting up an oratory in the parish to serve the parish and also to be an oratory. And many people usually ask me, what is an oratory? Or who are, someone said, who are these praetorians? I mean, oratorians. It's not a word, it's that. The oratorians, go back really time to the time of St. Philip Neri, 1500s. Their most famous member, probably, besides St. Philip, is John Henry Cardinal Newman. They became very successful and are still very prominent in England. So if you visit England or know England, you know the work of oratorians. One of the most famous oratories is the Brompton Oratory. But they say the British dropping all these speakers. Oratory. And I've also put in the bulletin a little summary of what the oratory is about. So you have this little insert. I tried to get it on YouTube, but I'm not there yet. So I had to write things. I'm old-fashioned, I still write. So it's on there. I'll give you the basic facts about the oratory and their good work. Also, my letters in the bulletin, too. You can read all the details. Especially me to read the middle section. Has to do with the Latin masses. solid Catholic education, by the way. I'm sure he'll tell you all a lot about how your children and grandchildren go there. Thomas Aquinas. And that has developed in the last 40 years. He will be the pastor, and then Father Patrick Driscoll, who is from around here, but ended up in St. Louis, will be the parochial vicar. So I encourage you to offer your warm welcome to these priests, and they are enthused about coming here and working here at Star of the Sea. They're setting the foundation for this new oratory. So they are certainly wanting to work. They're not coming here reluctantly. They're coming here to get to work and to further this important group. They have their own charism, as we say nowadays, a certain charism, just like the Jesuits do, and the Dominicans, or the Franciscans. But they'd say to you, we're not like any of them. So you'll have to let them give you some talks on who they are. But when it comes down to it, you'll find out that they are doing parish work. They're parish priests. Whether you're a Franciscan, Dominican, whoever you are in a parish. A parish is not a place to enter into some sort of dream world. It's a place of people, things going on, a lot of souls in need, and that's what they will be committed to. So that's the latest news about the parish. I ask for your prayers for this transition and for myself. After they get settled here, I've been going on a sabbatical for about 6 months, and then I will come back to a different assignment. If you ask me what it is, I don't know. So whatever the Archbishop wants, I will go there. But I pray for me during that time, because on a sabbatical, you have lots of time to think and pray and to look at things. So I hope I come back better. Sometimes you come back better in spite of yourself. So just keep that in your mind, in your minds and prayers these days. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost, amen. Today we have the Mercy, Divine Mercy Sunday. And this has nothing to do with the church, because we have this gospel, which is the traditional gospel. It's also used in the ordinary form of the Mass today, which shows us God's love and mercy the very day of the resurrection. Is very explicit. It makes sense that the very day Jesus rose from the dead, that he made clear that we would have his forgiveness, his mercy, channeled to us through a special sacrament. That is the sacrament of penance, or you would hear reconciliation, or going to confession. All those are still appropriate and good terms, all about the same thing. And as we know, he called down the Holy Spirit upon them, and he gave them that particular power. Receive ye the Holy Ghost, whose sins you shall forgive, they are forgiven them, and whose sins you shall retain, they are retained. Why did our Lord do this? That's a question. And still, even most devout Catholics over here say, why can't I just confess my sins to God? Why do I have to go to a priest? And there are many Catholics who never in their whole lives been comfortable even with confession, especially very sensitive souls. You know, we're not all the same. Some of us are tough as leather. Some of us, someone blinks the wrong eye at us and our feelings are hurt. So very sensitive souls, confession can be a great difficulty, because you have to accuse yourself of your sins, and you're afraid of what someone else is going to think of you. Well, we shouldn't worry about God. He sent his Son to forgive us our sins. He loves forgiving us sins. The present Pope said, God never gets tired of forgiving our sins, but we get tired of asking for forgiveness. We have that side, that little stubborn side of us, that we don't like to admit we were wrong, or that we're less than perfect. But anyway, our Lord established this sacrament. He wanted us to be sure that mortal sin is forgiven. And this is very, very important. Because to have sin forgiven, you must have a perfect act of contrition if you don't go to confession. A perfect act of contrition is sorrow, deep sorrow, and a promise to make amendment of life, because it offends the God of love. And not because we may be fearful of punishment. Whereas being the fickle people we are, often we would be sorry merely because of punishment, the fear of eternal punishment. But in the sacrament of penance, God makes up for this imperfect intention and forgives mortal sins, certainly, even if we have the intention of fear of punishment. Eternal damnation. And so that's why we say it's the only way to be certain your serious sins are forgiven. Unless you used to live in a community where people would go door to door promoting their religion. And there was a group there, they'd ring the doorbell, ding dong. Oh, good morning, Father, how are you doing? Are you saved? Have you ever had that happen? That's the key in getting the foot in the door. Hello, friend, are you saved? And Catholics usually don't know what to say, which makes them more interested in you. Because if you hesitate, it tells them they think you're not saved. And then some Catholics who study a little bit might say, well, I don't know if I'm saved, I'm not dead yet, but I'm on the way, or something like that. But I always thought it would be nice to say back, are you saved? And then they say, sure, I'm saved. I've accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior. I have to be saved. I'm certain of it. Aha! But you can't be certain unless you have the sacrament of penance. No one ever thinks of saying that to me. Oh, the sacrament of penance. When did that come about? Where is it in the Bible? John chapter 20. It's right there in the Bible. I lived in the Bible. That's why I try to avoid not to be like that. I lived in the Bible. Every funeral, every wedding, everything was the occasion to try to get the whole congregation to be saved before they left, whether they liked it or not. And the sign of being saved, you come up to the altar rail and give your life to Christ. But you cannot be certain. Only through the sacrament of penance, which should tell us something as Catholics. We must be certain our mortal sins are forgiven. In other words, we must be certain that we are raised up in Christ, that we're not dead in sin, that the power of Christ's death has destroyed our sins through the sacrament, and we are alive. That's what we celebrate at Easter. I am alive in Christ. I'm raised up, I'm in grace, I'm in Christ the Lord, I am certain of this. There's nothing on my conscience and anything that was there I have confessed. I am in the state of grace, as we say. I am reborn, I'm a new man, I'm a new woman. Years ago at Easter, everyone bought new clothes, I remember that. My brothers and I just love getting our new fedora. Mine would blow off my head and run down the street, and I had to go after it. That was a sign of being raised up in Christ, by the way. New clothes, the new flowers, the springtime, newness, freshness. frozen hard, and bitter. And then came the spring with the daffodils and the tulips and the gladiolas and the crops coming up and the fresh air. One of the side streams there was no longer below freezing. You could walk around without fear of frostbite. So that's change, newness. This is what Christ wants us to have. That's why we speak of his divine mercy, his love for us. And this is the foundation. So we cannot advance in the Christian life unless we have that. Otherwise, if we receive communion in mortal sin, we do not receive the grace. If we are confirmed in mortal sin, we do not receive the grace, even though we are confirmed. If you are married and you're in mortal sin, you do not receive, you're married, but you do not receive the graces that will help you to live out the married life. Or if you fall back into mortal sin after being married, you don't receive the graces to love your spouse and to do what is required of married people. There's a block there. It's like a dam over there. Or even the priesthood, diaconate, and episcopacy, if you're in mortal sin, you don't receive the graces to be deacon, priest, or even bishop. The anointing of the sick is the same way. All the sacraments require that we be in a state of grace, except, of course, baptism. That's why the early church, they said, please baptize me. After they would do talks like the one I'm giving now, they'd say, I want to be baptized. I can't wait. Of course, they were worshiping devils and killing people, throwing them to lions and doing awful things like that and going to sexual orgies and drunken things. And all in the cult of Satan. They couldn't wait to be freed of that. But all of the sacramental life is built on that. You must be in the state of grace to grow in grace. And so we always have to be careful. That's why Catholics have to rediscover this sacrament. Pope John Paul II devoted his whole pontificate trying to get Catholics to rediscover the sacrament, and he has explained it in beautiful ways. One way he explains it is, yes, God is rich in mercy, but remember the healing powers of forgiveness. He heals the wounds caused by our sins, the hurt, the pain, the disappointment, the nastiness, the ugliness, the enmity that enters in. He heals that. Sometimes it's a long healing. Sometimes it takes decades. I don't know where I would be with some people's experiences that you hear about. If someone took my, and this is a true story, if someone took my beautiful young daughter, who was 21 years old, and killed her in just cold blood in sport, threw her, wrapped her body up into a rug, off the side of the road. I don't know how long, I think it would take me a long time if we did that. But there comes healing. And if you don't forgive someone, you keep them in their sins, you know. Because every time they see you, they know that you are right and they were wrong. And they see you and it reminds them that they're bad. So you have to come to forgive them. Doesn't mean you move in with them. But there has to be some sort of reconciliation, whatever that is, peace of mind. That's what the whole mercy of God is. So God is forgiving to us, we must do the same. We must be merciful. They often say, you know, the story of the prodigal son. He was prodigal in sin. But really, it's the story about the prodigal God, who is prodigal, rich in mercy, and always ready to take us. So that's what we think of today on Divine Mercy Sunday. God's loving mercy and how wonderful it is to be raised up in Jesus Christ, to be alive, to be in grace. And that's the life that will take us into eternity, where we will live forever and ever in the presence of God. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Spirit.